sing his praise.
All the people of God sing his praise.
Everything that has breath shout for joy.
Everything that has breath shout for joy.
Everything that is beautiful
belongs to
to that was a little underwhelming, all right? Because that was just fantastic. What a way to start the service today, declaring how excellent is the name of the Lord, because there's only one name under heaven by which we're saved. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. So I think as a church, we can do a little bit better this morning, showing our gratitude for Jesus and who he is and what he's done, and really giving him more of our heart's affection and our mind's attention this morning. Amen? Can we just do a little bit better than that? All right? All right. So I want you guys to really enjoy it this time, so just stand up, and here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to direct the music here for a minute this morning, all right? And we're going to pick it up on how excellent is your name, all right? I'm so blown away, I'm speechless. But we're going to do it with just the band first. I want the band, because I just want to hear the band for a minute, because And you guys, if you don't take time to just tell these folks thank you for what they do week in, week out, to drop them a note, you know, Mike is here all day, almost every single Sunday, into the evening, right? I mean, some folks think we don't have Sunday night church. We have Sunday night church. We have so much that goes on here on Sunday nights. It's unbelievable. And Mike typically doesn't even go home on Sundays. This band, they're up here early. They stay late. They're up here various nights of the week. The choir, all these folks, man, they sacrifice so much so that when we walk in this place, we have the opportunity to worship God through music. And you might not always like the music, but you ought to always love the people who are singing it and playing it. Amen?
Amen.
And if we can't do that, something's wrong with our heart. All right? So here's what we're going to do. I might just take over and let you preach today, all right? All right. So we're going to start with the band, How Excellent Is Your Name, and I want y'all to do that a few times through, and then I want y'all to bring the choir in, but then I want the band to drop out and just the vocals, all right? Can we do that, choir? All right? Let's do it. Ready? Yeah, Mike's going to love me, man. I'll buy you lunch tomorrow, brother. I'll buy you lunch tomorrow. And if you're checking us out, you're visiting with us today, we're so thankful you're here, and we just pray you'll experience the presence of the Lord here with us today. You'll find a green tearaway tab in our worship guide, and maybe you'd like to find out more about Grace Life. Feel free to give us your information, or you can find our information inside the worship guide as well. Or if you're a part of our Grace Life family, and maybe you're not going to be able to be in Sunday school today, if you'll just put your name on that tab, as well as there's a place down there for Vacation Bible School. We need to start figuring out who's going to be serving the Lord at Vacation Bible School this year. So if you're going to be able to help us with that, maybe you've got a specific area or no preference at all, just check those boxes and put your contact information there for us also. There's even a place there if you have a prayer need today that you can just write in whatever the prayer need may be in your life, and that doesn't get published. That's just for the pastors to be able to pray for you today, later on today, and throughout this week coming up. Also in the back of the worship guide, you'll see a lot of things coming up over the next couple of weeks and the next month or so in the life of our church, so be sure you check that out. And right there, smack dab in the middle, is our Grace Life Conversations, and we hope this is a resource that you're putting to use somehow in your life. And right now, our life verse, we have a life verse one time for every 3 weeks. It changes every 3 weeks. And I want you to say it with me today. It's right there near the top of the middle page from Ephesians chapter 6, verse 7. You ready? Serve with a good attitude, as to the Lord and not to men. Let's say it again. Serve with a good attitude, as to the Lord and not to men. Let's pray. Lord, we do want to serve you today with good attitudes. Lord, this is all for you, and it's all about you. And Father, we thank you for the gift of music, Father. We thank you for the men and women who prepare so diligently to lead us in song. And Father, we pray that today that it wouldn't just be about the music, God, but it would be about our hearts. It would be about our lives. And that today, truly, our mind's attention and our heart's affection would be completely and solely on you, God. There is no other one who deserves that but you. So God, thank you for bringing us together here today as we begin a brand new week. We thank you for the rain that has come tonight and early this morning, and we thank you that most of us got to come in today dry. And we thank you, God, for those blessings today. But most of all today, our prayer is that your son Jesus would be lifted up in this place, that people would be drawn to him, and that our lives would be changed for your glory and for our joy. And we pray this in his great name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. All right, turn and speak to some folks around you. Meet somebody maybe you don't know. Let's continue to worship the Lord together. Let's see my butt.
to share something with you. I love hearing you guys sing. I love that so much. I'm so grateful to be a part of a church family where you guys sing. And we sang that last song, and it says sing praise. And I chose that because it says sing praise, because there's something special about when we come together and when we sing to the Lord. His word is very clear on that. His word, over 400 times, there are references to singing in the Bible. Did you know that? And 50 of those times, at least, it's an actual command to sing, not a suggestion. Now, if you are a parent, you know that there's a big difference between a suggestion and a command, okay? So if there are 50 commands to sing in the Bible. Now, I have good news for some of you that may think that you're a non-singer. Some of you all that think that singing is just not your thing and you don't really connect with it. Some of you who may be afraid to sing because you're afraid that somebody may actually hear you. Well, I have good news for you, because when you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you became a singer. Okay? He's given you a new song to sing. And what's so great about that is, while it is very clear in the Bible that for those of us who are on stage, that we are supposed to be skilled and trained, for God's people in general, there's only one thing that God says about that, and he says it in Ephesians 5. It says that we are to make a melody in our heart to the Lord. And that's what God looks at. He looks at our heart. And when you are singing, when you are opening your mouth and words are coming out as an overflow of your heart, then when those words cross your lips, it becomes a beautiful, beautiful song to our King. So I want us to sing that as we sing this next song, Sing to the King. I want you to sing like you've never sung before. I want you to worship the Lord with your lips. Sing to him out of the overflow of your heart. That's what he looks at. He doesn't care what it comes out as when it crosses your lips. He wants to know that your heart belongs to him. That's what he wants. Let's sing to him, church, for his glory and for the honor of his name. Let's sing together. Here we go.
Thank you.
loves to hear his people sing. He loves to hear his people sing, and Satan hates us to sing. So I want you guys to keep singing. You sound awesome. So good. Let's sing this next song. We introduced it last week. It's called Man of Sorrows. This is about the cross. This is about what Jesus did for us. This is about that we. This is why we cherish the cross, because of what he did. Let's sing this together.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man, wrath of God, has been on Jesus' grave.
This next verse is silent. Likes that.
Pray. Father God, the question comes to our hearts this morning. Are we ready for your coming? And I pray, God, that each person in this room can answer that question with assurance. I pray now, Lord, for your word this morning. Be with Brother Joel as he brings the message, Lord, that you might touch our hearts this morning, that we would always be in service for you. Bless this offering. May it be used for your name's honor and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Have a seat. Let's continue to worship together.
You dance so. How I
Guys, worship the Lord today, and sometimes I get to watch you worship the Lord. Sonda was just standing. I was watching you, Sonda, stand and worship the Lord. And Sonda and Matt McGowan have been a part of our church family for several years now. And about 6 months ago, the bottom sort of fell out in their life as Sonda was expecting their fourth child. And he's here. He's healthy and all that great stuff. But a lot of great uncertainty for a season there in their life. And then just last Sunday, her and Matt were voted in. Matt will be the pastor at a church in Sweetwater, Texas. And so we're going to miss the McGowans, but we praise the Lord. And I knew when I saw you standing, Sonda, that was the cry of your heart. Lord, I'm amazed by you. They put their house on the market in Helena. I don't know if you know much about how fast real estate's moving these days. Not real fast, right? They had their house on the market one day. Interesting story. The person, the home inspector who came out to inspect their home is from the very town that they're going to be serving the Lord in Sweetwater, Texas. And so when you see that lovely young woman over there standing up and singing, Lord, I'm amazed by you, she's not standing up just to draw attention to herself. That's the cry of her heart. And I want you to know that. I want you to know that we just need to be reminded, we don't know what people are going through in this room. We don't know the ups and the downs that they're facing, and some of us would do a whole lot better if we would stop thinking about ourselves and stop thinking about everybody else around us and really just worship the Lord. Amen? Amen? Amen. All right, now. If you got a Bible this morning, would you open it to John chapter 19? John chapter 19, we're in a sermon series called Any Last Words, just looking at the last seven sayings of Jesus from the cross, and this is our third week to do that. We're leading right up to Easter here. The first week, we looked together at the word forgiveness, as Jesus said, Father, forgive them, because they don't know what they do. And in the second week, we looked at the word of assurance last week, when he said to the thief on the cross, surely today you will be with me in paradise. And today we want to look, if you summarized, I think what Jesus is saying today, you could summarize it with the word love. It's the word love. And now just to kind of set the scene for us here, you just got to remember that Jesus has been up all night. He's gone through six trials. He's gone through three Jewish trials. He's gone through three Roman trials. All of them are illegal. It's against the law to be trying somebody at night. So they're just railroading him to the crucifixion. And after those trials, they beat him. They torture him. They ultimately nail him to the cross. And the crowd is shouting insults at him, blaspheming him. And at this point, everybody's left him. Everybody has forsaken him. Everybody has abandon him, and none of the disciples even show up at the cross except one. Do you know who it is? It's John. John, probably the youngest of all of the disciples, probably the one who, if any of them were closer to Jesus than any of the rest, it would be John. He oftentimes calls himself the beloved disciple or the disciple that Jesus loved. But we also know that not only is John there, but a group of women also show up, and we're not exactly sure who all of those women are. We're not even exactly sure quite how many are there, but the one thing we do know for sure is that one of those women in that cluster of women is Mary, the mother of Jesus. And of course, by now she's older than when we first met her back in Bethlehem. Now she's probably somewhere around her early 50s. She's probably a widow by this time. We don't hear anything about Joseph from the time that Jesus is 12 years old and teaching in the temple and to the time his earthly ministry begins. So it seems that in all likelihood, he's gone. He's out of the scene now. And so here is Mary standing at the cross, watching her son, her oldest son, suffer and die. And she's there with the other women, and she's there with John. And she has watched as they've beaten him. She has watched as they have stripped him, as they have tortured him. She has heard the cries coming from the crowd, the slanderous, the vile things that they have been saying to Jesus and about Jesus, and there is absolutely nothing that this mama could do about any of this. And Jesus, in this moment, he looks down at his mother, and he looks down at his best friend, and he ignores the crowd. And in the quietness of that moment, he makes the third statement, John 19:25. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. And when Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." When he says, "Here is your son," he's not talking about himself. He's referring to John. He's saying, "Mom, here's your new son, John. And John, here's your new mom." We don't know anything really much about John's mom, but we know that in this moment, Jesus is doing something amazing. We're going to break it down in a moment. He says to his mother, "Here's your son, John. And John, here's your mother." And from that time on, this disciple took her into his home. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word, and we are amazed by you. Father, I pray that would be the cry, the song in every heart here today that knows you, is that we're amazed by you. Father, I pray for those who maybe today have come in and they're not amazed by you. Their thoughts have not been on you. Their hearts have not been on you. Father, I pray that you would move in our hearts, our lives in such a way today that we would leave from this place today not amazed by the sermon, not amazed by the music, not amazed by a Sunday school teacher or anything else, that we would leave this place amazed by you, Jesus. So, Holy Spirit, you teach us and change us. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. So in Jewish thought, the words of a dying man were really equal to his last will and testament. And Jesus was saying to his mother here, "Mom, I'm leaving you. I'm not going to be able to take care of you after this, after I'm gone. So, Mom, there's nothing else that I can do for you." And he's saying to her, "Here's John. John is going to be to you just like I've been to you. John is going to be the son that you need." And he's saying to John, "John, you see my mom? She's your mom now. I want you to love her like I've loved her and like I would love her. And I want you to take care of her like I would take care of her." And so you ask maybe why, in the midst of all this agony, in the midst of all this torture, in the midst of all this suffering, would Jesus say something like this? I mean, what's the value here? What's the point of this? What's going on here? And I think it's because that even though he's dying this terrible, awful, horrific, agonizing torture on the cross, he is still fulfilling the most basic responsibility and the most sacred obligation that a person ever has. And that's to take care of his mom, to take care of his family, to care for his parents. And although Jesus is here doing the most important thing that any person has ever done on this planet, he is dying for the sin of the world. In that moment, he does not overlook his mom. In that moment, he is not too busy to take care of his parents. And so from this statement on the cross today, what I really hope we take away from this really is two things. First of all, how to love like Jesus. I don't know about you, but I'm on a mission to try to learn to love more like Jesus loves. I want to get better at the way I love people. I don't want to just love people better in my own strength and my own effort, but I want the Holy Spirit to work in me in such a way that I am loving people the way Jesus would love people. I hope that's your prayer. I hope that's your ambition as well. So this morning, we're going to look a little closer at what it means to love people the way Jesus loves people. But not only that, we want to look at how to suffer like Jesus, because Jesus is suffering here, and he models some things for you and for me for those times that we're going through suffering as well. So the first thing we learn is how to love like Jesus. First of all, loving like Jesus means, number one, caring for my family. Loving like Jesus, first of all, means caring for my family. I've got to learn to care for my family. This is what Jesus is doing in this moment from the cross. We hear that in his third statement from the cross. He's caring for his own family. You see, love is something you do. It's not just something you say. It's easy just to toss the phrase around. It's easy just to say that you love somebody. And here's Jesus in the middle of all his pain. He's hanging there suffering and bleeding on the cross. And we find that Jesus gives three things to his mother. And it's the very same three things that you and I need to give to our family members if we really want to love them the way Jesus loves his family. The first thing that Jesus gives and that we ought to be giving our family is the gift of provision. The gift of provision. What is Jesus' last earthly task here? He's providing for mom. Do you see that? I mean, some of you in this room right now, you're taking care of your mom. You're taking care of your dad. They're at that season, that stage in their life. That's your ministry. That's your sacred obligation and privilege to do that. And we find Jesus here giving his mother the gift of provision. He's got nothing really in terms of material things to give his mother. She's not going to get a life insurance policy. He doesn't have a home that he's leaving behind. Even the clothes that he had are now gone. And the Roman soldiers are casting lots over that. So what does he do? Better than giving her things, better than giving her stuff, he gives her the greatest thing. He gives her care. He cares for his mom. And he takes the person that he trusts the most, which is John, and he takes the person that he loves the most, and that's his mother. And he says to John, care for my mom for me. Take care of her. This is your new son, he says to his mother. Well, what does that have to do with us, you say? Well, the Bible is very clear and very plain that we're to provide for the needs of our family also. In fact, if you have a Bible, turn to 1 Timothy chapter 5. 1 Timothy chapter 5. In 1 Timothy chapter 5 and verse 3, this is what Paul writes. He says, give proper recognition to those widows who are really in need. Who are really in need. But if a widow has children or grandchildren, these should learn first of all to put their religion into practice. God says, hey, you want to know what real religion is? When you take care of your folks. You want to know what really pleases the heart of God? When you take care of your grandparents. This is what real religion is, he says. Put it into practice by caring for their own family and so repaying their parents and grandparents, for this is pleasing to God. Listen, we have a deacon's ministry at Grace Life where we want to care for the widows and the widowers who are part of our church family, but that never comes ahead of the responsibility that mom, that woman, that man, that their children has toward them, or that their grandchildren has toward them. This is where real love starts. Godly, Christ-like love starts with the family. And that's how you please God. Taking care of your elderly parents, of your elderly grandparents, or your elderly in-laws. Taking care of your family. Hey, that's where love really starts. 1 Timothy 5:8, if you continue there, if you're there already, says this, anyone who does not provide for their relatives, and especially for their own household, has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Pretty clear, isn't it? God says, hey, you ignore the folks in your family that have a need. You don't care for them. You're worse than a pagan. You're worse than somebody that's still dead in their sin. You see, love starts at home. It starts with your family. Man, I'm blessed. My parents are in good health, and I'm learning from them. I've watched them care for their parents, and one day we're gonna have to care for them. We'll be glad to. Where's Bryant? But I've learned a lot watching my mom and dad care for their folks. I've learned a lot watching some of you care for your parents. The way that you love them, even the ones that you're mad at, you got to care for them, you know? Even the ones maybe you're bitter against, you still care for them. You got to get rid of the bitterness. And you got to step up and you got to fulfill that sacred obligation and that sacred duty. Jesus gave the gift of provision to his family, and we should do the same. And secondly, after he gives the gift of attention, he gives the gift of attention. The gift of attention. And we need to give the gift of attention to our family as well. Jesus paid attention to his grieving mom who was standing there at the foot of the cross. This is what love does, right? Love pays attention. How do you know that somebody loves you? They pay you attention. We got this little dog at home. I'm going to tell you, he's not loved. I can tell you how he's not loved. Nobody really pays him any attention. This is how you know what love is. It pays attention. And you've probably seen those movies, right, where there's this crowd and there's all this noise and all these people moving about and so forth. But all of a sudden, two people kind of lock eyes together. They give each other their attention, and then everything else just kind of grows blurry, you know? And you kind of lose sight of all that, and everything else kind of gets quiet as these people are showing attention to each other. And that's really what's happening here at the cross for Jesus. In the midst of all this crowd, in the midst of all this stuff that's going on, all that just seems to go away, and all that he can see is his mom. He gives her attention. He's dying on the cross, and he ignores the pain, and he ignores the suffering, and he ignores the insults that are being hurled in his direction, and he focuses on his mother, and he gives her his attention. You know, attention is one of the greatest gifts you can give somebody. Attention is better than giving somebody stuff. Attention is better than giving somebody money. Because attention requires your time. You can get more money, but you can't get more time. The most precious thing we have is our time and our attention. When you look somebody in the eye and you say to them, I'm listening. I hear what you're saying. I want us to talk about this. You're saying to that person that you matter to me. You're saying to that person you have worth. You're saying to that person you have value, you have dignity, and I respect you and I honor you. Listen, my question to you today is, are you living like Jesus? Are you loving like Jesus? Do you need to be paying more attention to your own family? Husbands, do you need to be paying more attention to your wife? If you're loving like Jesus, you pay attention. Wives, do you need to be paying more attention to your husbands? If you're going to love like Jesus, it requires that you pay attention. Do we need to be paying more attention to our parents and to our grandparents? Or do we need to be paying more attention to our children? So many dads, they sit there with the remote control in their hand, and their little child comes up and says, Daddy, look at me, look at me. And what's that little child saying? Daddy, love me. Pay attention to me, Dad. What are we saying? So I love what's on the TV, right? I love what's on my tablet. I love my time in Facebook, and I love doing this, and I love doing that. That's where my time is. That's where my attention is. Are you really giving your family the attention that the Lord would want you to give to them? Jesus did. He saw his mom in pain. He saw her grieving. He saw her hurting. And what did he do? He paid attention. So Jesus gave the gift of provision, and he gave the gift of attention. And thirdly, he gave the gift of emotion. And we need to give the gift of emotion too. Here's one of the most tender scenes in all of Scripture. Mary, the mother of Jesus, is watching her son as he's been tortured, and now as he's hanging on the cross, and John, his best friend, standing there with her, and they're both in agony. They're grieving. They're being crushed. This is a gruesome scene that's playing out right in front of their eyes, and they're miserable and they're overwhelmed with grief. They're brokenhearted. Imagine the emotional torture that Mary went through her whole life. Beginning from the time that she's a teenager with an unexpected pregnancy and a pregnancy that's hard to explain. Imagine the emotional torture of knowing the fate of her son. The emotional torture of watching people try to trap him, and watching and hearing the people make accusations against him. Oh, he runs around with sinners. Oh, he's demon-possessed. Those are the sort of things they said about her boy. Or when he goes back to his hometown, Nazareth, imagine being there watching the hometown crowd try to shove Jesus off a cliff. That's what they did in his hometown. The emotional torture that his mom had gone through his entire life, and now this. Watching him be tortured as if he's a criminal. And she's at the foot of the cross, and Jesus is hanging there with his feet pierced and with his hands pierced, and don't you doubt for a second that her heart wasn't pierced. She was suffering on that day as well, and she's in major grief. And what does Jesus do? He looks down and he pays attention. He pays attention. He provides for her needs in spite of his own pain, and he comforts her in that moment. What is he doing? He's entering into her emotions. He's given her the gift of emotion. He enters into what she's feeling in that moment. See, loving like Jesus means that I got to care for my family. Are you loving like Jesus today? Are you really caring for your family the way Jesus would have you care for your family, the way he cared for his own family? Loving like Jesus means not only that I'm caring for my family, but number two, caring for my faith family. Loving Jesus means that I'm caring for my faith family in the same way that I care for my own family. It's interesting that Jesus had some half-brothers and half-sisters. He had at least four half-brothers and at least two half-sisters. The reason they were half-brothers and sisters is because they shared the same mom but not the same dad. Jesus was born of a virgin. It was a miracle of the Holy Spirit that brought this conception about in Mary. Joseph adopted Jesus. It's interesting here that none of his brothers and sisters show up at the cross. Where are they? Where's the people who are related to him by blood? Where are they in this moment? Well, John chapter 7 tells us they didn't believe that Jesus was the Messiah. They didn't trust that he was who he said he was. And it wasn't until after the resurrection that his own family would finally say, "No, we believe he indeed was the Messiah." And so here's Jesus. He's taking care of his mother in these final dying minutes. And we don't find that he entrusts her to his brothers. He doesn't entrust her to his sisters. Instead, he entrusts her to a fellow believer. He entrusts her to somebody who is in the faith. Somebody who has put their trust in him as the Messiah. And why does he do that? Because oftentimes our spiritual relationships with each other are even stronger than our biological relationships with each other. You see, it's not just that we should care for our own biological family, but we need to be caring for those who are part of God's family, for the family of God, for the household of faith. The Bible's clear that I've got to treat other believers just like my family. Now listen, if you're not treating your family well, don't treat believers the same way, okay? But the assumption is if you're treating your family the way they ought to be treated, then bring that to God's family. Continue treating God's family the same way. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 50, here's what Jesus says. He says, "Whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and my sister and my mother." You're following God. You're trying to do his will. We're in the same family. We've got a really big family. And I'm not just talking about the Grace Life family. We got a really big family. We're talking about church with a capital C here. We got other family members today who are worshiping in all other churches around in this community. We've got brothers and sisters who are worshiping in other parts of the world. Sometimes people say, "Well, you know, why are we doing what we're doing over there? Why do we care about Dr. Rami? You know, we just found out he got safely home from Yemen. Praise the Lord for that. Why do we care about that? He's so far away. That's my brother. He's as much of my brother as Bront Frederick is my brother. And I want to pray for my brother, and I want to encourage my brother, and I want to support my brother, and I want to stand with my brother." You see, loving like Jesus means that I'm going to take care of my family, but it also means I'm going to take care of my church family. I'm going to love them the way God wants me to love them. Galatians chapter 6, verse 10 says, "Whenever we have the opportunity to help anybody, we should do it. But we should give special attention to those who belong to the family of believers. Help anybody who has a need, but Paul says, but pay special attention to your brothers and sisters in the Lord. Pay close attention to each other. So loving like Jesus means I'm caring for my family. Loving like Jesus means I'm caring for my faith family. Number three, loving like Jesus means I'm caring for people in pain. I'm caring for people in pain, even when I'm in pain. I'm going to care for people who are hurting even when I'm hurting. I've got to see other people's pain even when I'm in my own pain. I've got to be looking out for people who are suffering even when I'm going through a time of suffering. See, I don't just help people when my life is gravy. I don't just help people when things are just going swimmingly with my own life. It's not the way Jesus lived. It's not the way Jesus loved. It's not the way you and I are supposed to live. It's not the way you and I are supposed to love. Even when we're suffering, we're to care for those who are suffering. Even when we're in pain, we're to care for those who are in pain. Think about Jesus. Things aren't going real well in this moment for Jesus, right? He's suffering. He's bleeding. He's dying. He's in excruciating pain. And he's in his dying moments, but is he focused on himself? No, not at all. He's looking around to see who else is in pain, who else is hurting, who else is suffering. And he sees his mother and he sees John and he sees their pain. Listen, here's the model for us. Even as Jesus is in excruciating pain, he's looking for others who are in pain. Who can I love? Who can I serve? Who can I help? That's what it means to love like Jesus. To love like Jesus means you care for other people who are in pain, even when you're in pain. Philippians 2 verse 5 says that our attitude should be the same attitude as Jesus. In other words, what he did, we're supposed to do. It means when we're suffering and we're hurting and we're in pain, we need to be looking around to find who else is hurting, who else is suffering, which is, by the way, how you begin to get out of your own pain. That's how you begin to break free from the pain that you're experiencing, not by wallowing in it, but by looking around to help somebody else. Our natural inclination is to wallow in it, isn't it? Our natural inclination is just to throw a pity party. Woe is me. Nobody's ever had it as bad as I have it right now. Nobody's ever suffered near as bad as I'm suffering right now. Nobody's ever been mistreated like I'm being mistreated now. But listen, if we're going to love like Jesus, we don't wallow in our pain. We want to use it. We want to be good stewards of it. Even in our pain, we want to look around for other people who are hurting and who are in pain. Some of you have been grieving. Some of you have lost a job. Some of you are brokenhearted. You've lost a loved one. And as your pastor, I want to say, I'm sorry. I really am. I'm grieved that you're grieved. And we're supposed to rejoice with those who rejoice and grieve with those who grieve. And we want to know about that, right? I mean, on that green tab, write what we can be praying for you about. Or call us. My cell phone number is in the worship guide. 800 people get my cell phone number every single Sunday. And they text me, and they call me, and my email address, it's in there, as well as the rest of our pastors. Why? Because we want to love you. We want to care for you. We want to be able to pray for you. By the way, don't think because you posted on Facebook that we know about it. All right? Facebook is not our tool that we use for ministry here, all right? So don't get mad. You know, I'm having gallbladder surgery tomorrow. Y'all pray for me. And then the pastors don't show up. And you're mad because the pastors didn't show up. Don't Facebook us, all right? I don't even look at Facebook. I've been on it one time since Christmas. That was to clean out about 30 emails y'all had sent me. I'm not on it. Don't want to be on it, all right? But we want to know. We want to care. We want to be able to pray for you. But here's the key. The key to getting out of your grief and out of your sorrow and moving on from your pain is to refocus. It's to refocus. If you just keep focusing on yourself and wallowing in it, that's going to go nowhere. I mean, grief is a good thing. We're all about that. We want to walk you through that grief process, but we don't want you to live there the rest of your life, to just sort of shut down. Instead, we want you to refocus and find people around you who are grieving, people around you who are hurting. Yeah, I lost my job. But who's worse off than I am? Yeah, I've got a relational difficulty, but who's got something that's worse than what I'm going through that I can love and encourage? look around and look for ways to refocus. So loving like Jesus means caring for my family. It means caring for my church family. It means caring for my faith family. It means caring for people who are in pain, even when I'm in pain. Because we see Jesus doing that. And fourthly, caring for people with needs, even when my needs aren't met. We see Jesus doing that, don't we? He's caring for people who have needs, even when his needs are not being met. Listen, if I'm going to love like Jesus, if you're going to love like Jesus, it's going to require of us that we care for the needs of other people, even when our needs are not being met. We can't just sit back and cross our arms and say, when everybody loves on me, when everybody takes care of me, when everybody meets my needs, then I'm going to start meeting everybody else's needs. No, we got to go for it right where we are. Even when we're suffering, even when we're in pain, even when we have needs that aren't being met. And Jesus has emotional needs as he's hanging on the cross. He has great physical needs as he's hanging on the cross. And were his needs met? No. We'll eventually get to where he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? But in the midst of his own needs not being met, in the midst of his own pain and his own suffering, he's making sure that other people's needs were met. To love like Jesus, that's what's required of us. To make sure that as best I can, the people around me, that I'm meeting their needs, even though my own are not met. It's interesting that Jesus is hanging there on the cross and he doesn't say, hey guys, I'm sorry, but I'm really hurting too much right now. I'm suffering too much right now. I got too much going on right now. Suck it up, Mom. At least you're there and not up here. Come on. Jesus doesn't say that, does he? That's not his posture. That's not his attitude. He's not saying, hey, what I'm doing here is way, I'm dying for the sin of the world here. Making atonement, all right? Providing justification here. That's what I'm doing. A little too big to worry about your tears right now, all right? That's not the way Jesus is at all. The most important task, the most important job, the most important assignment in all of history is what Jesus was doing at this very minute, paying for the sin of mankind. And let me just say to you, there's nothing that you or I are ever going to do that even comes close to being this important. Nothing. Nothing. The most important thing that I would ever do in my life is not even going to come close to what Jesus is doing in this moment. And yet, he makes time for other people, especially the people in his family. And what does that say to us? It says to us when we say things like, listen, it's a real busy time at work right now. For the next 6 months, I'm on this project. I got to close this deal, so I'm not going to be able to spend a lot of time with my family. Well, you're on the wrong project. You're working on the wrong deal then, because God didn't put you on the planet to do projects. He didn't put you on the planet to do deals. He put you on the planet to love people. He put you on the planet to have relationships with people. And there's nothing that any of us will ever do that gives us the right to ignore our family. You with me? There's nothing that important that it would make it okay to not love our family well. There's nothing that's so important for us to do that it would be okay to ignore our family. Jesus is paying for the sin of the world, and even in that moment, he looks down and he says, I need to take care of my mom and I need to take care of my best friend, because it's all about relationships. So don't tell me your purpose is greater than Jesus's. It's not. Don't tell me that your plans are more important than his dying on the cross for us. They are not. Your stuff is not that big a deal. Are you loving people well? You caring for your family, caring for your church family, caring for people when even you're in pain, you're caring for people who are in need, even when you have needs. Romans 15:1 says, we who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Each of us should please our neighbors for their good, to build them up. We should please our neighbors for their good, to build them up. I just want to pause for a minute. Yesterday, Mr. Carter, the Carter family, who lives right here next to us at the church, we only have two property owners that touch our property here on this campus. And one of those two, they lost everything yesterday in a house fire. And so I don't normally do this, but I just felt very impressed when I found out about that and talked with the pastors about it this morning, that at the end of this service today, before we dismiss, I just want us to pass the offering plate. And if God would just put it on your heart to give, to encourage them, to help them, to bless them, then I want to give you that opportunity to do that before we leave here today. Now we don't do that all the time. In fact, it's rare that we would ever do that. And certainly we're not going to do that for everybody that has a house fire. But when you talk about neighbors and you only have two property owners who touch your property, I think if we don't respond to that in some way, I'm not sure that would be pleasing to the Lord. And so if you just disagree, then don't give. But if you agree with me, then later on, I want you to have that opportunity, because this is what the Bible's saying here. Each of us should please our neighbors, serve our neighbors. You know, you say, well, I got needs today. Well, we're supposed to care for the needs of others even when we have needs. You say, well, I'm hurting today. I know, I get it. But see, Jesus cared for other people who were in pain even when he was in pain. And so here's just a real easy way for us to live out what God's called us to do. That's what it means to love. And not just the Carter family, but look around for people that you can help. Adopt a widow. Find an elderly man or a woman that maybe you could bring into your small group. Go find a single mom who's got three kids, and she's working as hard as she can to try to make ends meet, and just commit. You're going to make a meal for her one time a week. So at least on that night, she doesn't have to come home so tired and so worn out and try to put a meal together and help get her kids' homework done and get them to ball and then get them bathed and in the bed. Maybe just help that one night. Who are the people around you that you could be helping? See, this is what it means to love like Jesus. Jesus died as he lived, thinking about others. His first thing he said on the cross was, Father, forgive them. He's thinking about his enemies. The second thing he said is, surely you'll be with me in paradise. He was thinking about the criminal next to his side, on his right side. The third thing he says is what he says today. Woman, behold your son. He's thinking about his mom. Jesus died exactly the way he lived, thinking about other people. And do you not agree with me that we ought to be living that same way? We ought to be living just like Jesus, spending our effort, our time, our energy, thinking about other people, loving other people, serving other people. That's the way we ought to die, is giving ourselves away, loving other people, thinking about other people, serving other people. You say, Joel, I would love to do that today, but I can't. You don't know how deep the pain is that I'm experiencing right now. You don't know what I'm going through right now, how deep the hurt is. And you're right, I don't know. Maybe you're grieving the loss of a loved one, or you've recently lost your job, or there's chronic physical pain in your life that is so difficult to face day in and day out. Maybe you're facing fear and worry and anxiety, panic. Maybe depression has just jumped on you like a fat kid on cake, and you just can't shake it off. Look, I'm a fat kid. I like cake, all right? And you say, Joel, I'd love to do what you're talking about, but man, the needs in my own life, the stuff I'm going through, is just too much. I just want to encourage you this morning with a couple of last thoughts about that then. Number one, what if my pain and my needs are overwhelming me? Number one, remember that Jesus cares about your pain. Don't forget that. Don't lose sight of that. Jesus cares. I promise, he really, truly cares about your pain. You need to remember that. Just as he's there dying on the cross, what is he doing? He's caring about the pain of other people. And he cares about your pain today. Maybe you just needed to come today just to hear somebody remind you that he cares. Jesus cares. You don't get anything else, just remember those two words today. Jesus cares. He does. Secondly, If you find that the pain that you're going through is overwhelming you, I want to encourage you to get connected to genuine Christ followers. Get connected to genuine Christ followers. People who really love the Lord. People who are really trying to follow the Lord. It's not just enough to get connected in a small group or into a Sunday school class, all right? There's a lot of people who are trying to be genuine followers of the Lord. And that's great. We commend that. We encourage that. We're all about that. But I would encourage you today, don't just get connected to people who are just trying. Get connected to somebody that's anchored, all right? Get connected to somebody who's really just stable in their relationship with the Lord and in their relationship with other people. You weren't meant to handle life by yourself. You weren't meant to go through pain and sorrow by yourself. You need to learn to accept love from other people. Connect in well to this church family. Join a small group. Join a Sunday school class. Become a part of this church family. Don't just be an attender, but say, hey, I need a family around me to help me in life. Thirdly, if you find that your pain's overwhelming you, find somebody that you can help. Find somebody you can go help. Just begin to refocus your life a little bit. Refocusing your life is the key to overcoming grief. It gets the attention off of yourself. It's amazing what begins to happen when we just stop thinking about ourselves and we start thinking about other people. Find somebody else to help. You say, but I don't know how to do that. I'm just hurting so bad. Here's the cool thing. To love like Jesus is not a mission that's impossible. He gives us His Holy Spirit to give us the power to do what He's telling us to do here in His Word. You be willing to do it. You step out and you make yourself available and He'll empower you to do it. And then finally, if you're being overwhelmed by your grief, your hurt, your pain, your sorrow today, I would say to you, keep looking to and looking for Jesus. Keep looking to Him and keep looking for Him. One of the things that I often tell people when I'm counseling with them, when they're going through pain and hurt and sorrow and grief, one of the things that I always tell people to do is, I say, hey, do you have a journal? Usually they say no. So get a journal, get a notebook, something. And what I want you to do is, some of you need to apply this. Every night before you go to bed, I want you to write one prayer to the Lord. It may be a sentence, it may be two sentences, three or four, I don't know. But I want it to be a prayer of thanksgiving. Write out what you're thankful for at the end of that day. Write out how was it that you saw the Lord move in your life that day. How did He provide? How did He work? How did He love you? How did He encourage you throughout that day? And write it down. It's not enough just to think on it, because by the next 24 hours, you've forgotten already. But write it down. And some of the cool things that will happen out of that is you begin to live your life then looking for, what am I going to write down tonight? You begin to live your life looking for, what is God going to do in my life today? How's He going to love me today? How's He going to bless me today? How's He going to encourage me today? What is He going to do today? And so I'm watching for that. It's about looking to and looking for Jesus. And I want you to know this morning that I believe Jesus wants to love you well. He wants to bless you. He wants to encourage you. He wants to minister to you. He wants to give you His very best. Just like He wanted to give His best to His mom. Just like He wanted to give His best to John. These were the people that He loved the most on the planet, and He gave them the best that He had. But here's the key. He couldn't do it if they weren't right there with Him. He couldn't do that. We wouldn't have read these words today had John ran away with the rest of the disciples. We wouldn't have read these words today if His mom had never shown up. He gave them the best that He had because they were close to Him. Listen, this morning I would just ask you, are you close to Him today? First of all, do you know Him? Have you trusted Jesus to be your Savior? But then, are you close to Him? You see, they were at the foot of the cross. They had to be close because I don't believe He was shouting this. I believe this was just a whisper from a dying man. And they were close enough that they could hear Him whisper. Are you close enough in your walk with the Lord today that you can hear Him whisper. They were at the foot of the cross, and I would suggest to you this morning, whatever it is this morning that you need, you'll find it at the foot of the cross. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for Your amazing love, Your relentless, faithful, and steadfast love. Thank You that You loved us before we loved You. To imagine that scene on that day as Your Son hung there doing the most important thing that's ever happened on this planet, suffering, not just physically, but suffering separation from You, His Father, and to see His love. God, would You teach us today, and would You change us in such a way that we love people like that? God, I pray that we would be found loving our families well today. God, I pray for those who are in families that are fractured and stressed and strained, and maybe there's bitterness and anger. God, I pray that we would not use anything as an excuse to not do the right thing. That we would love even when our needs aren't met. We would love even when we're in pain. God, that this love wouldn't just stop with our family, but that we would love our brothers and sisters in Christ with that same kind of relentless love. That we would think a whole lot less of ourselves and more about those in our lives and those around us. Father, I pray for those today who are in great pain, experiencing great need, great heartache, that You would encourage them today to take a step forward and to begin to look outside of themselves at somebody else they could love, that they could bless, that they could encourage, that they could minister to. And God, I pray that today we would all just move in closer to You, we would move closer to the foot of the cross so that we could hear Your gentle whisper today in our hearts. God, help us today to turn our eyes from all other things and just look to Jesus. We pray this in His name. I want to invite you to stand with us. He's called us to love like Jesus. Are you doing that? You can't do it on your own. But if you'd humble yourself before the Lord, yield your life to Him, and allow His Holy Spirit to fill you, control you, you'll love your family like that. You'll love your church family like that. In spite of needs, in spite of pain, we'll be loving folks around us like Jesus. What an example He sets for us. And what joy to know He gives us the power to be able to do that. So as we sing this morning, I want you to obey the Lord. Maybe there's some distance between you and the Lord. Maybe you're one of those Christ followers that's not at the foot of the cross today. Maybe you've ran away. You're just not where you're supposed to be. This morning, I believe He's inviting you to draw near, to turn your eyes on Him, to listen, to hear Him and what it is that He's saying to you. So let's obey the Lord this morning. Let's sing together.
Oh, soul, are You weary and troubled? No light.
of earth and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Amen. Don't you find that to be true? We just turn our eyes to Jesus. It's amazing what happens to our perspective, doesn't it, on life. I want to ask you just to grab a seat for just a minute, and we got an opportunity to love like Jesus today, okay? So I'm going to ask our ushers if they would just to come do this all over again, and all of this is just going to go to our next door neighbor right here. I think they're kin to Brandy, right? Y'all are family there. And so just as you can, as the Lord has put it on your heart to give, you can make a check to Grace Life, all right, designate it to the Carter family, and we'll make sure that we get them all of that, that you're giving today. Thought about having Sonda come play and sing for us, but she might kill me if I asked her to do that. Would you kill me if I asked you to do that? Huh? No thanks. And ushers of the choir would like to participate as well, so don't forget them. Now, ushers, I know that the counting folks back there, nobody knows that we're doing this, and so they're going to look at you like a new baby calf at a gate or a cow at a new gate. What's that old saying? I don't know. They're not going to have a clue what we're doing, so y'all figured that out. I got no words of wisdom for you. Thank you guys for being such a giving church, a caring church, and generous. Did we get you guys yet? Okay, good. Hey, I'm glad you guys were here today. I hope you'll make it to a Sunday school class today, get connected in there. Next week, we'll be back to the fourth saying of Jesus from the cross. God bless you guys. Have a great day.
Yeah, well, it'll be fine, I'm sure.
But, you know, she enjoyed it. I was so glad Sarah got to know.
Yeah, Sarah had a blast.